So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time. We glorify you. We honor you. We give you all the glories that you deserve. Father, you are high above us. Your thoughts are not our thoughts and your ways not our ways. We are gathered together tonight, Lord, in your name via Zoom, and we are so thankful for that. Father, you've been so gracious unto us, and we want to thank you for our Mendoza Family Bible Study Group. We pray, Father, that you will continue to bless and protect our family group. Help us, Father, to bring you worship that pleases you. We lift up your name and help us to be an encouragement one to another as we go to your word. Help us to give attention to your word. Thank you, Father, for preserving it. Bless Dennis as he preaches, and we pray that you will be honored. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
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 Amen. Just like in Hebrews 10:25 says, let us not give up meeting together, as some in the habit of doing, but encourage one another. So, Dennis, we're ready to listen to the word of God through you.
Okay, thank you, Edith. Thank you, Tita Sonia, for the prayer. And I'm thankful to God for the presence of everyone. I'm always happy when we as a family can gather together via Zoom to worship God, to have fellowship, and to study God's word. So today we have a very simple message which I pray will bless all of our hearts, which can be found in Psalm chapter 119. This is the longest chapter in the Bible, Psalm 119, and we will be meditating on verses 17 up to 24. Okay, this will just be a brief meditation. The title of the devotional, which I have posted on our chat group, is The Word and Life. Some of you have heard the advertisement, Coke adds life. But actually, when you think about it, if you drink Coke every day, instead of adding life, it will even deprive you of life, no? Because a lot of sugar can cause serious sickness and disease. But the word, God's word, can really add life. And that is what we will be studying this day. Okay, so I'd like to put the passage which we will be studying on the screen. Okay, so please wait for it a bit as I try to share this passage on the screen. Okay, so there it is. Okay, there it is. This is Psalm 119. Okay. Let me read it. Deal bountifully with your servant that I may live and keep your word. Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. I am a sojourner on the earth. Hide not your commandments from me. My soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. You rebuke the insolent, accursed ones who wander from your commandments. Take away from me scorn and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. Even though princes sit plotting against me, your servant will meditate on your statutes. Your testimonies are my delight, they are my counselors. This is God's word. May God bless the reading of His word. Okay, so today we will be meditating on how the word adds life to us, gives life to us. And there are two things actually which I will be sharing with you today. And it has to do with the fact that the Word of God preserves our life and the Word of God protects our life. So just two things, no? Preservation and protection. Okay. Now, you will notice in verse 17, I will just go through the verses one by one. Hopefully, this will not take long. Please note that this is actually a prayer request. Deal bountifully with your servant that I may live and keep your word. Okay? He does not explain, David does not explain what he means by deal bountifully, be good, be kind, be gracious to me, O Lord, I am your servant. Be good to me so that I may live. In other words, he was asking for more life. He was asking that God preserve his life. But for what purpose? So that I may live and keep your word. Actually, this is a very brief statement from God's word, but it answers a very important question that so many people are struggling with. What is the meaning of life? Why am I alive? Why do I ask God for more life? And the answer is, if ever we should ask for more life, the purpose of life is for us to love God, to obey God, to serve God, to obey His will, to keep His word. And in the book of Ecclesiastes, if you go there, you will find out that that is the whole purpose of life. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. In other words, our lives are given to us not for the sake of satisfying our own desires or accomplishing our personal dreams, although I am not saying that that is wrong, but the ultimate purpose, and this is the purpose for which all our personal desires and ambitions and dreams should be subordinate, is really to fear God, to glorify God, to serve Him, to love Him. Otherwise, there is no point for additional years in life. That is, if ever God preserves and prolongs our life, it is because He still wants us here on earth to fulfill His will, to keep His word. So we learn from this very short verse a very important principle. Life is intended for the glory of God so that we might be able, as long as we are alive, to fulfill His will as it is revealed in His word. That's why, if you will remember, the Apostle Paul in the book of Philippians chapter 1, okay, verses 21 to 24. If you remember, the Bible says, "For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, okay? Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ. That is far better, of course. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account, because while we are here on earth, we can glorify God by serving others. We can be an example of what it means to live according to the word of God. But to sum it all up, I will not stay long in this verse. If ever we should ask more years from God, more life, if ever God preserves our life, this is the purpose, that we may keep His word. So the question I would like to ask of everyone is this: God has given us the gift of life. How are we using this very short life that God has given to us? Are we using it for our own satisfaction, or are we living our lives for God? Are we living our lives in accordance with His will? Are we obeying and keeping His word? Okay, so we are still in the first point, the preservation of life. We go now to verse 18. Open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. You might ask, what is the connection between verse 18 and verse 17? Very simple. The word of God is that which really preserves our life, as I will show you in a little while. But we cannot understand this on our own. Left to ourselves, we do not have the wisdom and understanding to really comprehend what God is revealing to us in His word. So we need to pray to God, open my eyes by means of your Holy Spirit. Enlighten me, O Lord. This is a prayer for enlightenment, and it's very necessary. Now, let me go back to the point which I mentioned, that the Word of God is really very beneficial. There are so many wonderful things or wondrous things that can be discovered in God's Word, in His law, so many precious and wonderful things that are really very beneficial and profitable for us, no? And it's all there in His Word, but we need our eyes to be open to understand this thing. So here is what the Bible says, no? In Proverbs chapter 3, verses 13. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, her profit better than gold. She is more precious than jewels. Nothing you desire can compare with her. So the wisdom of God found in His Word is more precious, more valuable than money. Long life is in her right hand. And in fact, better even than that, eternal life is found in God's Word. In her left hand are riches and honor, not merely material riches, but the infinitely more precious spiritual riches, spiritual blessings, no? And honor. What is more honorable than to be cherished and treasured by God Himself? Her ways are ways of pleasantness. All her paths are peace. As the Bible says, great peace have those who love your law, and nothing shall offend them. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who held her, pulled her fast, are called blessed. You want to be blessed? You want to be truly blessed? Then read, meditate, study, immerse yourself in the Word of God. But you need help. We need help. We need our eyes to be open. Why? Because the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 3:12, okay, the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him. He is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. We need the Holy Spirit. The Spirit who is from God was given so that we might understand the things freely given us by God. Okay? So the Word adds life. The Word gives life. But we need our eyes to be open so that we might see these wonderful life-giving truths in God's Word. Okay? So we go now to the second point. The second point is about protection. The first thing is about preservation. But the second point is about protection. I am a sojourner on the earth. This world is not our home. We are just a passing through. And this world is full of trials. It's full of troubles. It's full of temptations. Without the guidance of God's Word, we might fall into danger. You know why? If you remember, the Bible says in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 to 16, if you remember, it says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Okay, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. That is the world we live in. Okay, we are passing through this world. It is full of temptations, full of trials, full of dangers. We need guidance. Otherwise, as you will see in the next verses, we might, wander away, and that will be very disastrous. So, the commandments of God is what will keep us from falling into temptation, from falling into dangers, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. As Psalm 119 itself says, no, in verses 9 to 11, if you remember, the Word of God says, thy word have I hidden in mine heart that I might not
sin against
thee. Okay? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Hide not your commandments from me. In other words, David is saying, help me, O Lord, to always remember your word. It will be my protection against temptation. Okay. So, and we hear in verse 20, David reveals what is in his heart. And my prayer is, by way of application, is that we ask God for a heart like this, because this is really special. This is really unique. My soul is consumed with longing for your rules at all times. This is a person who is passionate about God's word. Now, my question to all of us is this. What is your passion? What is your obsession? Others, their passion is money. Their passion is fame. Their passion is success. Their obsession is for earthly, or they are obsessed with earthly things. But David, he was obsessed with God's word. This is strong and intense language. My soul is consumed with longing. I am burning up with desire for God's word. You know, as I read this, I feel moved, no? Imagine. While others are passionate about things that will not last, he is passionate with God's word, for God's word. No? Burning up, consumed. In other translations, the word is translated crushed. I am crushed with longing. So let's pray to the Lord. Lord, make me like David. Remove from me unworthy desires and unworthy ambitions. Instead, make me passionate for your word. If I am to become obsessed, make me, Lord, obsessed instead with your word, instead of obsessed with material things. Okay? And then, as I said, verse 21, if we will not, you know, remember God's commands, heed his word, the danger is this. You rebuke the insolent, accursed ones who wander from your commandments. If you will not remember, if we will not remember the word of God, we might wander away. We might become disobedient. And you know, as the Bible says, what you sow, you reap. You wander away from God's commands. You disobey God's commands. The result will be divine chastisement. You rebuke. That's divine chastisement. That's divine punishment. The Bible says in Galatians, I think it's chapter 6, no? The Bible says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. God is not mocked. No, you cannot just despise the holiness and justice and righteousness of God. He will really, you know, you will really reap what you sow. We will reap what we sow. Disobedience will be disciplined. Of course, if you are God's child, even when he chastises you, he does it out of love. Because, you know, a father who cares about his children will discipline them for their own good. No? So if you are really a child of God, you will not resent being disciplined or rebuked by our loving Heavenly Father who knows what is best for us. But still, no, why do we have to go through that pain if we can avoid it? And generally speaking, we can avoid that kind of rebuke if we are obedient to God's word. You rebuke the insolent, accursed ones. I don't really have time to explain that. But every time we disobey the law of God, we are being arrogant, insolent. That's the meaning of insolent. And I mean, accursed, no? I mean, you bring divine curses upon you. Ultimately, that is more applicable to those who are not children of God, okay? Because their life is really, what is it? Their life ultimately is one of disobedience. If you are really a child of God, you will obey. No? Even if you stumble sometimes, you will rise up and continue in the path of obedience. Finally, okay, we are still in point number 2. Take away from me scorn and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. This is really sad, no? If you think about it, David is praying that he be able to avoid the consequences, another consequence of disobedience, scorn and contempt. If you are a Christian and, for example, you backslide, people are looking at you and they will mock you. They will scorn you and they will say, I thought you were a Christian. Now there's no difference between your life and mine. And you will be an object of ridicule. So it's really tragic if this happens to us, no? So that's why as Christians, let's really be careful to heed, keep, obey the word of God, no? Because if we become careless and fall, it will really bring a lot of shame, not only to ourselves, but it will also put the word of God to shame. No? So let's pray this prayer. Take away from me scorn and contempt, for I have kept your testimonies. Keep me faithful to your testimonies, O Lord. Finally, okay, we're still in protection. We're still in the second point, but we're about to end. Even though princes sit plotting against me, your servant will meditate on your statutes. You know, when you are not faithful, people will scorn you. But if you are faithful, they will persecute you. That's the, how do you call this? That is the irony, no? So that's why in the case, thank you for that. That's the right word, the irony. So what is important is no matter what happens, you really just find your delight in God's word. You just stick to God's word all of your life. Does not matter anymore what other people say. Your testimonies are my delight. So we're back again to something he said earlier. No? His passion was for the word of God. They are my counselors. Back again to what we said about guidance. Guidance from the word of God. So let's end with this application. So here are people who hate David. No? They were plotting against him. But he remained faithful to God's word. It was his delight. He meditated on it day and night. What about us? Where do we find our happiness? Is our happiness founded on material things and the opinion of other people? What if material things fail? We will no longer be happy. What if people begin to hate us because of our Christian convictions? We will no longer be happy. No. Our delight, our joy, our happiness is not based on this world and on whether people hate us or not, whether they love us or not. Ultimately, it does not matter. Our delight, our happiness is in the word of God. For that is where we find wisdom for life. Not Amen. Just life here, but eternal life with the Lord forever. May God Amen. Bless our devotional for today.